Yeah.
Okay, good morning, everyone. And I have a pleasure and privilege of introducing the first keynote of the YR conference, Dr. Harleen Kaur from New Delhi, India. And to start with the introduction, I want to tell you a little story. I was browsing the International Journal for Casting, and I was noticing more and more articles, not about forecasting, but strictly about prediction. And what caught my attention was the great article by Harleen about the prediction of the football matches. So we reach out. We reached out and we were able to connect with Harleen and invite her to our conference. And just to briefly to very briefly introduce Harleen, I was very shocked that during her academic career she was collaborating quite intensively with Poland, but she also worked in Japan. So Harleen in Japan, in Italy. So Harleen, the floor is yours and I am looking forward to your presentation.
Yeah, hello everyone. First of all, let me congratulate the YR Foundation for organizing such an informative session. And also this is my privilege to share my thoughts on some predictive application and analysis and showing you with some good results. So here I will discuss one such application in which we have predicted a football match outcome. So what we have done, let me show you some of the result and how we have did the analysis and modeling of a football result. So the thing is that the machine learning... Okay, a machine learning application, when we talk about, so it is being used virtually in a lot of many application areas. So potential application areas of machine learning, or you can say data mining, are tremendously broad. Like you can use in financial fraud detection systems, you can use in any of the information and communication technology sector, and you can also use in cryptocurrency, bitcoins, identification, a lot of many application domains are there. So, but let me concentrate on the application which I'm going to present in this talk is that in this talk, we are building a generalized predictive model. So from that model, we have predicted the result of sports by using some data of a FIFA match. So we have created a very highly accurate the system of predictive modeling where we did the analysis and give a new, very good new application. So a lot more application areas are there, but in support, we are talking about here, we are only talking on the events we are talking about, that is sporting events we are talking here. Just like you can use a machine learning application in a cricket, horse racing or basketball, a lot more applications are there. But the thing is that in this talk, we are more only concentrate only on the football match, which is giving a very huge significant in terms of economic values. So here we have taken the data, we did the analysis, then did the modeling, and how we have discovered the new promising results from a sports data, which can lead to a prediction and which can also give a very good analysis when we are doing a betting of a football match. Because the thing is that the main concentrate here, we can create a highly accurate predictive system using a machine learning. So we have demonstrated the strong dependence of a machine learning models. A lot of models we have used here, then did a comparison and give a very good and accurate result at how this model is best suited for this football matching. If we do a betting of a football match, because the thing is that, as we have seen in the news also, the football betting market, it is around $700 million to $1 trillion. A lot of worth of football betting market is there. So modeling a predictive system for academic is okay, but modeling a predictive system for a sports system is a very good nowadays. So previously, a lot of many authors, they work on this. They have used a Bayesian network. They have predicted sports event, giving error rates by using a Bayesian network. So a lot of more machine learning models and techniques they have used. Some have used k-nearest neighbors, and some have used as naive Bayesian learners, and some have used a lot of recent decision tree systems. The thing is that similar studies, a lot of authors they did, but they have given the accuracy of 92%. So here, what we are doing the prediction. We are doing the psychological state of the players, whether or not one of the main players will be injured, or what will be the prediction, what will the prediction or the weather condition. We are doing every prediction. Let's do this thing. The most popular sports are there. Football is one of the most popular sports, because as you heard that English Premier League is the most watched sports league in the world. So it has been broadcast a lot of million homes and territories with a potential TV audience. So football, which is also called as a soccer, is one of the most popular sport in the world. So several countries have many football teams competing in both regional and national championship. So in recent years, new type of data have been collected from many, many, many games around the world, around various countries. So such as the play-by-play data. So a lot of data has been captured. So a lot of machine learning techniques or models they have used. But that particular my area or my area of working here or doing a talk in this, I focused on the machine learning in a football match and how we have predicted what is the performance of each team. So the possible outcome of a team is divided into home win, away, win or draw. So the thing is that to predict the outcome of a game, we have used some traditional predictive methods. So some, we have used a match result to evaluate the team performance. So due to some low scoring, so it is very difficult to predict. So what happened we did, we go through a potential solution to this problem, because we need to predict a very good and accurate prediction we have did. Because in my study, what we have demonstrated, we have shown that our best model is of machine learning. We have used with a gradient boosting method. We have used a random forest method. We have used a support vector machine. A lot of methods we have used, but later we have did a comparison and we got a result that our best model using a gradient boosting achieved a very good performance. So we have taken a game weeks of result from a 6 to 38 week of English Premier League. So we have aggregated over two seasons, 2014 and 2015 data, and 2015 to 16 data we have taken and we have concentrated on that data. So what we get that the result of the football match, we have created a highly accurate predictive systems using a machine learning. So let's see how we have done. So our research focuses, we have used a feature engineering system. So we have extracted the number of features. So we have extracted the features and we have applied that in our machine learning techniques. So what we have done, we have tested our feature set using a Gaussian name-based methods. We have tested using a random forest method and we have used a support vector machine. and gradient boosting models also we have tuned with. So we have discovered that fine tuning for each model was done at an optimal performance using a feature selection, because we have obtained our data from a public domain data sets we have taken. So we have used our data from a 2005 to 2006. So we have developed a predictive machine learning model using a Gaussian based random forest, gradient boosting, and SVM for creating some feature sets. So we have obtained our data. As I told you, we have taken a public domain repository, Data Football UK. We have, this is my public domain site from where we have taken our data. So we use the data from 2005 to 2014. Some data we have used for our training data, and some data we have taken for our test data. So if we have taken a 70% to a 30% ratio also. So as each span, we have taken 9 seasons for experimental purpose. So why the thing is that, why I have worked with the feature engineering? Because I got a lot of features in my data. A lot of features, they are not much of importance. They may hindrance my prediction result. So what I used, I have minimized or reduced the number of features. The features which are important, then that only I have given to a machine learning model. So the quality of feature set is one of the very important tasks. So whether a team is home team or away team, these are global characteristics. We have formulated using a mathematical formulation. We have used a feature engineering technique for selecting our relevant features, best performing features. So we have increasing our feature space, used our modeling system, which gives the importance that effects which can lead to an effect of the prediction. So it is help in predicting the outcome of a football match, because quality of features is only the relevant feature is only gives a very good result, because bad feature may hindrance, may give the bad result. So quality of feature, the collection of data, what we have taken the prediction task, which is associated directly with the quality of feature set, which is used for modeling of the system. Because from my understanding, or from both our understanding, the understanding of a problem domain, our predictive analysis suggests that the selection of correct set of features is one of the very important tasks. So one of the most crucial aspect of our research was the feature engineering step that may help in prediction. The outcome of the football match, the outcome will be very accurate. So in our study, my area, we have did a feature engineering techniques. We select the relevant feature and gives the best performing features. So here you can see these are the number of features are there. So you can see from my data. So we have strapped, I've divided into two classes, that is class A and class B. So the data is divided into two classes by using, we have obtained our data, as I told you, from a public domain data repository. We have used a feature engineering techniques by selecting the most relevant features. So best performing features only gives the best performing results. So you can see from here table, these are 33 features. So after going through the extensive feature engineering technique, we had combined these 33 features. Since we have a very large number of features, so greatly increase the feature space. So we have to reduce the number of features, since large number of features gives a very feature space dimension will be increased. So my aim is to select the best performing features, most relevant features. So what we have done, we have divided the number of features into class A and class B. So we have divided into class A and class B. So both for both home and away team, as you see in the table also, which contains class A contains the individual features from a home and away teams, where here you can see. So class B obtained the differential features. So my rationale behind class B features was twofold. So firstly, the differential feature had a much better univariate distribution, as you see in the figure also, which is quite useful for some statistical learning techniques. So by encoding the same information by two variables into one, we are able to reduce the number of dimensions of the problem. So hyperspace, which makes our model less prone to get stuck in a local minimum. So we tested our features using a Gaussian A-phase. We have used a phase support vector machine, random forest, and gradient boosting methods by fine-tuning them by optimal performance through feature selection and hyperparameter. So here we have used two classes, class A and class B feature, that found a much better on the later set. So you can see here the class A and class B features are there. So as I told you in my talk also, that where class A contains the individual number of features for both home team and away team, and class B contains the differential features. So rationale is that the class B feature was a twofold. So here you can see in the figure also, the home team attack rating is this, which is quite useful, which gives a better univariate distribution for some statistical learning techniques. So same information held by two variables also you can use into one. So we are can able to reduce the dimension of the problem by hyperspace, which makes our model less prone to get stuck in a local minimum. So as here we have described that we have used different models we have used. So let's talk about one of the, after doing a feature engineering technique, which model we have used first. First, we have used a multivariate Gaussian naive-based model. This is the first predictive model that we employed on our feature set. So we have tested out both in a class A and class B features, found that it performs much better on a later set, which was quite explanatory as class B feature was better fit with a Gaussian probability density because it is one of the most efficient algorithm which performs thing. The classification in the classification problem is one of the best probabilistic methods used for a conditional probability of a data. So we observed some high correlation value. We observed some high correlation value after using the Gaussian naive-based model. So this was quite explanatory as the class B features was a better fit to a Gaussian probability density function, as well as there were too many features, there were many features that had high correlation amongst them. So we observed some high correlation values among the rating statistics, and thus we achieved a performance boost on dropping these predictors. So next model, we worked on a random forest model. By using a random forest machine learning model, what we have done, we have mapped the complex nonlinear decision boundaries. So we built the uncorrelated trees as to give a better or greater reduction in the variance by considering only a subset of a available predictors. So we have tuned our model The hyperparameters we have used are random forest search. No. Yeah. So what we have did, we did the most important parameter here. We have used a random forest is an where the number of trees we have built, and then splitting of a criteria to consider the maximum depth of each tree. So we have used this model. So this figure we get after tuning my model and tuning the number of parameters, what we get, this figure we get from a random forest. So in a random forest, what I get, this is a tuning for a number of trees. So we have used this hyperparameter optimization results. We got this result and tuning with a max depth and minimum sample split we got. So after doing the validation part, what we get from a random forest is that the random forest which give the from a confusion matrix after doing a validation of a two-fold and a five-fold, we get this results. So the thing is that these results we get individual basis, and later we have data comparison of each results. So after doing the random forest, what we did, we have used a support vector machine model. So this is a very effective and supervised machine learning model when dealing with the high dimensional feature data sets. So they have been divided into two types of models, linear kernel model and a RBF model, that is a radial basis kernel model. So SVMs are originally is basically a non-probabilistic classifier model, as everyone knows. And these here we have used the parameters C and a gamma, because these are only parameters we have used. So result from our model from a C and gamma is showing here. These are the results from a gamma, C and a gamma, that whenever the C gamma is large, you can see here in the figure, whenever the C gamma is large, the variance is small. Okay, so implying that a support vector machine does not have widespread influence on the data set. So large gamma leads to model with a high bias and low variance. So the result of hyperparameter is shown here. You can see larger is a gamma, which is result into a low variance and a high bias. Okay. So these are the results after we are getting from a validation. So we did some validation. We got this results from a confusion matrix, some precision and recall we have did, and we got results is that is that these are the showing figures are there. So after comparison, we can show that how which model will be the best. So let's do another model. So this is a gradient boosting model. This model we have used because this model is always work on a principle of boosting method. So this is our final predictive model we have used. This is a classifier which are trained on an entire data set with a model which gives the accuracy being approved after each iteration. So here we have used XGBoost for implementing the gradient boosting on a set of features. So one more author, they have used this. So for implementing the gradient boosting, which works on a principle of gradient boosting, that used a set of features. So XGBoost work on the principle of gradient boosting, and it is much more regularized model formulation to control overfitting, means it performs a better performance. So hyperparameters are greater than random forest when we have data comparison in random forest and SVM and a other models we have compared, and what we get that hyperparameters are greater than random forest model. It took a larger time to identify that which are the optimal values of a hyperparameter. So number of parameters we have tuned for optimal gradient boosting were always a greater than random forest, and it took a much more time. So these are the results from gradient boosting method. So this is a result is that the rate of gamma and a max steps. Okay, so this is a result of a hyperparameter optimization from gradient boosting. So we did the learning rate and a gamma. So what we get is that we again choose to use a grid searching method to find the optimal hyperparameter values. So we had tuned a large number of parameters. So we have displayed the result for a few important parameters. For example, gamma is there, and then other parameters, learning rate parameters are there. So this, the maximum depth for each tree and lambda, which controls the regularization and the strength. So the result of a grid search hypermeter parameter is displayed there is a considerable amount of time we have taken for optimal values of a hyperparameters. So the thing is that we have shown this result after doing the validation part. What we get, this is the result, what we get from a gradient boosting method is that we have taken a confusion matrix and precision recall table we have created, and let's do the comparison later on. So now the discussion is that originally three class, multi-class classification we have used, because we have divided the data set, as I told you, into training set and a testing set, is that we have divided into two sets we have divided, and some data we have taken, we have divided our data set into 9 season of a training set and 2005 and 2014 to 2005 till 2014 data we have taken, and remaining two seasons for 2014 and 2016 we have taken as a test data. So the thing is that we didn't break our problem into a binary classification problem. So we have used the original three-class multi-classification we have used. And then we have did the implementation part of the machine learning models. And we get is that we found that our best performing model was the gradient boosting method. So we get a very higher recall ratio. So we get 0.26, whereas, as I told you, and it is a much lesser. We got a gradient boosting, we got a greater, higher recall ratio than a random forest method. We got a 0.22 ratio. So model with the lowest accuracy was a naive bias. And the model with a best performing model, we got a gradient boosting method. We got a higher recall then a random forest. So 0.26 and 0.22, we got this. After doing the confusion matrix, we have compared our results. We have obtained from a Gaussian base, we have compared and did that we achieved quite reasonable result from our from other models also. We got results from a naive bias models. We got a very good result from SVM models also. But in terms of best performing model, it is always we performing model in a gradient boosting method or model, we got a very good result we got. So the thing is that even SVM model performed a good, but as we compared with the other models of machine learning, so random forest was also there, naive bias was also there. So it is much lesser than this thing. So here we have employed a tenfold cross-validation we have employed for determining the optimal value of K. So the result which are shown in my later slides also, which I've shown you. So we observed the best value of K from our gradient boosting method also the value of k from our method, which is always gone, which is always given a very good results as compared with random forest method and naive models. So confusion matrix, precision, recall results, which we have obtained from other models I've shown you. So we obtained a reasonable results from other model, but after doing a fine tuning, we get a good result from the gradient boosting methods. So models performed quite well on home winds with a precision recalls from a 0.26 and 0.66. So we have visualized and give the performance of our classifier by implementing the ROC curve. So our best model gradient boosting achieved the performance of 0.216 on the rank probability score, which we have calculated. So then we have compared with other model. So this is the ratio what we get. So by using the mean test accuracy score, we get the random forest as we compared with gradient boosting. It is always a lesser. So to overcome this, when we compared with the gradient boosting, we tested our result using the RBF also, linear also, naive-wise also. The random forest, if we calculate with the gradient boosting, so it performs gradient boosting method. It is always performed a good accuracy score in terms of mean test accuracy score. So the thing is that we get a score of good score we get. So it is near about 0.58 score we get. So after doing a feature analysis, we get this score. So it has been observed that the only two best performing models are there, which is a random forest model and a gradient boosting machine learning model. But if we compare the both, it gives the gradient boosting gives the good results. So the high importance of the swarm feature, which is much more significant than our feature. So we have implemented the ROC curve because ROC curve is very important. So ROC curve, the receiver operating characteristic curve, which we have implemented on our classifier. We visualized the performance of our classifiers. Which classifiers we have used, our machine learning models classifiers we have used by implementing our classifiers. Our ROC curve was built. So analyzing the ROC curve. So after analyzing the ROC curve, so what we get is that more useful and better in some avenues than individual error rate we have to calculate. So it is quite evident from the ROC curve that the gradient boosting classifiers, this is a SVM and random forest. So when you see the gradient boosting classifier outperforms the other models. So in terms of prediction of both the winning team and the draw stream, as well as the overall performance, the gradient boosting outperforms the other model. Because we are comparing with other models also, if we compare with the RBF SVM or if we compare with random forest model, the ROC curve, if we calculate the ROC curve, which is good for binary classification. So here we have extended to, as I told you, in a multi-class classification we have used. So by adopting this method, we got that gradient boosting is outperform our result. So accuracy of forecasting model based on ROC and RPS rank for probability score. So we have done that gradient boosting always outperforms our the methods. So these are the results which I got from my results from a 2014 to 2016, other test results we have taken. So this is our testing, other was training data sets. So we test our data sets on this. So we got that gradient boosted classifier was better at modeling draws than the other probabilistic models, the naive Bayes model. So it performs, outperforms the gradient boosting model, is a superior than a random forest from the result also we got. So gradient boosting was then calibrated for visualization. So we got the outcome classes. What we get is a wave in and draw and a home win. So we got this curve. So curve lies above the diagonal. So model underestimate all this. So we got this thing is that this is a result from a home win. These are the results from a away win. So we have compared with a calibrated. We are
We have a large number of questions on the chat. So if you could, if we can
Sure,
summarize your presentation, it
sure.
would be
We
really
have
great.
used our betting organ. We have used on other models also. We have used. So other than this thing, we have used the same data set on other machine learning models. So as I told you again that we got this random forest. Performs also the best, and gradient boosting performs the best. So these are all the predictions on a best performing model we are doing. So both model perform the best, but if we compare with other machine learning model, these are the giving a very good and reasonable results that we have achieved. So we can use this model for other events also we can use it. But we couldn't perform the book my maker's prediction we can use.
Harleen, thank you very much for this insightful presentation. So I will quickly go to the questions from the chat because we really have a lot of them. So the question from Ivy's B, which features were the best predictors?
Sorry.
Which features were the best predictors?
So as I told you from as I given my presentation also, you can see that figure which I've given that table. So we have divided into two class. So 33 features was the best features. So we got a lot of match features was there. We have to reduce the number of feature space. So 33 number of feature was the best features.
The next question comes from Dashala. Have you ever tried applying our results? Sorry, have you ever tried applying your results to the other football leagues than the Premier League?
I have applied only on the English Premium League. So other Premium League we haven't applied. So we have taken our
Okay.
data from a public domain repository, which was updated data we have taken. So this was our only data. It was stored there on that. So on that we have worked on the latest data.
Are you going to try to test to benchmark your model on the other leagues?
Yes, these things I've already answered that I will be going to apply for other technique if the data is available in the public domain. If the data is available, I can apply to other events in a FIFA or English Premier, other number of years we can cover in that.
Okay. Thank you very much, and we have a question from another question from Dashala. Have you tried Auto ML for H2O? And is do you see any benefit from using this such automated solutions in comparison with your handmade models?
Can you please repeat the question?
Have you tried Auto ML from H2O? The
No, not
auto
yet. In the future, I will try for my models.
out. Okay, great. Unfortunately, we don't have time for more questions. I suppose I suppose Harleen will be eager to answer them maybe by email or maybe during the prediction versus forecasting panel, which is happening in a few hours, and Harleen is also participating in this very panel. So folks, thank you for your questions. Harleen, thank you for being here, for accepting our invitation and sharing with us your great results. And I'm keeping fingers crossed. Maybe thanks to your research, we won't have to. I will be able finally to win something during my betting on football scores. Thank you very much.
Sure. Thank you very much.
Goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye.